All right, welcome tonight. This is Pastor Linda. We are talking for the thought of the day about some interesting topics that most Christians don't know anything about. And so I have with me David McPherson. He is an entrepreneur, businessman, inventor, and he has got some interesting information, some research that he's done that the things that he's dug up and found and wants to explain to the Christians about kind of what we're supposed to be doing on the earth today. So David, go ahead and introduce yourself and maybe share some things that you found.
Yeah, my name is Dave McPherson. I'm just moved to Tennessee, but I spent a lot of years down in Phoenix, Arizona as an entrepreneur. Had some heavy duty participation in the entrepreneurial community down there. And, as a Christian, part of my ministry is kind of volunteering for startups, and it's kind of led me into a lot of really high places, both in the corporate space, ministry space, political space, military space, medical space. Pretty much you name it, and I've been there in some capacity helping startup companies, or even with my own companies. So tonight I'd like to talk about something that a lot of people aren't looking at right now, which is there's so much focus on political manipulation, media manipulation, technology manipulation, but there's something that we have all heard of, which is data. And there's not a whole lot of attention on how data gets used and how the evil of the world, and I mean of the world, is against Christian conservative values here in the United States. So my intention with this chat is to just put it on everyone's radar to be mindful of data and how data is used, and be watchful and be prayerful about it. And I'll explain some of the companies, how it works and what they're doing with data, and kind of how I got into it. So my walk in the data space started in about 2001. I developed technology called, I called it Floor Talk, which I think there's another company came after that, used the same name. But what I did was I built a tracking system for shopping carts and people in let's say a Walmart or a Target. And the way that it worked is there would be an RFID chip on the shopping cart, and the customer would have an RFID chip on their keychain. And when they would walk into the store, they would grab a shopping cart, and as they passed through the metal detectors, it would register that shopping cart for that time it's in the store with that shopper. And there would be cameras, projectors on the floor, on the ceilings, all down every aisle. You'd have multiple projectors projecting images on the floor. And when that person got to the image, the store would already have built a shopper's profile on them from previous shopping experiences, and it would put discounted promotions on the floor in front of them, and the little bell would ring on the shopping cart to basically alert the person, like, hey, Coca-Cola or Lay's chips is 2-for-1 or whatever, and there'd be the ad right there in front of them on the floor. So
let me stop, yeah. David. Yeah. So you're saying this is something you developed?
Yeah, about 20 years ago.
Oh, wow. So let me ask you a question. Yeah. If I went into Walmart or wherever, how did that chip get on my phone?
It wasn't on your phone. It was on a key tag. So you would scan so you would scan your key tag when you walked in Walmart. You would scan it, and as you grabbed your shopping cart, and it would match that shopping cart to your shopper profile.
So this is something you actually had to get a little scanner thing then.
Yeah, Walmart. The idea was the grocery store, the Walmarts, the Targets would give you the key tag for free. Kind of like the 24/7 24/7 fitness centers that are out there where you just scan the tag to get in the door.
Right.
And then it tracks you once you get in the gym. Same exact thing. The technology has been out forever. It wasn't, you know, back then it was kind of innovative. That was 19 years ago when I developed it. I couldn't get any retailers to take it. At the time, I don't think retailers were that forward thinking, and it took a lot of explanation. And, you know, it was one of those things that just had to be proved out. And really, the technology got developed, but we never got it into a store to prove any theories. But my point in telling you this isn't to brag or boast on any innovations. It is to just kind of tell you where my experience in data and tracking and compiling of data to match it to personal individual profiles, it started way back then. So as I got heavily into entrepreneurship, that my experience in that and my, you know, the knowledge that people had knowing that I was in there in that space, it got me involved in a lot of startup companies or even existing companies that were building data tracking systems and you know, 10 years later, well, no, not 10 years, maybe 7 or 8 years later, as the world, you know, everybody's got their own blog, 2007, 2008, 2009, everyone's got a blog. The word SEO or search engine optimization is a keyword everyone's using. Mobile technology is just getting ready to kind of go forward with mobile smartphones. Social media was getting ready to explode. You know, all these things were happening. So the smart people of the world, you know, I would call them the people on the left, or, you know, the Democrat Party, they organized around building profiles on human beings in the United States. So ultimately, through 2010 to 2014, I ended up consulting with, you know, we had these things back then, we had link farms and data farms and all these buzzwords that most entrepreneurs in those days remember, and we all kind of laugh about it. But at the end of the day, right around 2010 was when the adversary really put an emphasis and a lot of attention on, after Obama won the 2008 election, that was, you know, they realized their data was the gold mine. So after Obama got in the first time, I'm sure people can remember, all of a sudden every news organization you saw had a Facebook logo next to every newscast, and all of a sudden Facebook and Twitter, their logos were on everything. And it wasn't because Facebook and Twitter were, you know, the best thing out there. There are lots and lots of social media platforms out there. It was because the people that were involved with Facebook and Twitter were also involved with CNN and MSNBC and ABC. So all of a sudden those organizations were promoting these social media platforms, and it drove, you know, it drove the world to go to those platforms and engage. So with that, coming into mobile phone use, smartphone use, probably around 2010, 2011, that's when data really, really, really started being extremely effective. So when you look at the two or three primary data compiling companies and who they are working with, that's what I want to talk to you tonight about, is how mind-blowing it is on what is against Christian conservative values in the United States. It is truly unbelievable that there are tens of thousands of organizations against our liberties and against their values. And it's actually, you know, going into this election, Linda, if you look at my Facebook post, if you go back probably till May, someone like me, I'm just a guy. I'm not some highly ranked political, military, or corporate guy. I'm just a guy. Okay. And I was able to prove out why Donald Trump, how I was able to justify by looking at data I have access to, that Donald Trump was going to hit at least 75 million votes. Now, to the contrary, we looked at it and saw that Joe Biden would have a hard time cracking 55 million votes. Now, the Republican Party has access to much greater data than I do, and they know these numbers.
So you're talking, so David, you personally could figure that out just by the how you know about data.
Yes, exactly. And I posted it, Linda. You could look at my Facebook post from back in the day. In fact, my buddy Chad, you're going to get a link to this video. Chad and I bet $50 some time ago that Trump, he didn't think Trump would crack 70 million. But again, we knew that Donald Trump had the enthusiasm to attract 70 million visitors. So if you look at, again, we talked the other day on attraction, conversion, and retention. Donald Trump has attracted, converted, and retained enough people to have pulled off 75 million votes in this election. There was not enough people. Joe Biden did not have enough people to rally around him as a candidate, for one, and for two, did not have enough people to hate Trump and our economy bad enough to vote for the guy. There was, according to data, there was no possible way Joe Biden could have pulled anything more than 55 million votes. And we were actually stretching those numbers to figure this stuff out. So
what happened, David?
So if you look at what happened, if you look at all the votes that were taken from Donald Trump, I got a list today, which I don't want to read it because I have to confirm it, but it looks to me like Donald Trump probably lost somewhere between 5 to 9 million votes in this election, where people in the ballot locations throwing stuff in the garbage, changing his vote to a Biden vote, votes getting lost in the mail, the technology systems changing votes from Biden to Trump, adding to Trump, adding to Biden, subtracting to Trump. So there's all these different aspects to the cheat that has happened this election that has added. I would be willing to bet everything I own that Joe Biden has had somewhere between 15 and 19 million votes added to his tally this year. And you know, if you look at how deceiving the mainstream media is, I took a couple of screenshots earlier. I was just browsing through. We have some algorithms we're monitoring. The mainstream media outlets. So this was just earlier today. It was live on, I think this was ABC. So ABC still has Joe Biden. This is NBC News. They still have Joe Biden as the official winner. And in one of these states here, okay, in North Carolina, according to them, Donald Trump has 50% of the votes. Joe Biden has 48.7. That's a 1.3% margin difference, okay? And they have it down as too close to call. On their, right there, you can see right on my phone, it says too close to call in the yellow right there, that little yellow line. Okay, too close to call. Okay.
So Trump has how many?
Trump has 50% of the vote, exactly.
Wow.
Biden's 48.7. So that's a 1.3% difference. And they say that it's too close to call. Okay. But here you have.
How much of the vote are the ballots have been counted?
98% roughly, according to them. So here you have them calling. That was North Carolina. So now they're calling Pennsylvania in Joe Biden's favor. And they are reporting Pennsylvania to be 49.7% Biden, 49% Trump. So that's a 0.7 lead that Joe Biden has, according to ABC News, which they can report whatever they want to. But they're calling Biden a winner. And even though North Carolina, Trump has a 1.7% lead, but they're calling that too close to call. You have Pennsylvania where Joe Biden has a 0.7% lead and they're claiming that that's, you know, he's won the race. Okay. And they're doing the same thing. Arizona is a 0.4% difference. And they're showing, you know, they're saying it's too close to call. But my point is, the media just manipulates the numbers to get the results that they need. And if they were really, really consistent, and if too close to call meant one candidate was a point or two higher than the other, and there was some kind of a threshold or some high to low sphere, and they were really fair and honest reporting, then they would have several states that would say too close to call, or they would just call them all for that candidate because it's all in the same threshold of vote ratio. So we're experiencing this, you know, everybody knows this mass manipulation of the people in this country, and they're dividing, they're making people hate. But the way that they're able to pinpoint the individual person is by targeting with data. So what I want to talk about right now is the companies that are empowering what I call the CIA media or the Democrat media with data to target messages that's hyper-targeted towards all the way down beyond zip codes. I mean, they target, very, very micro, small areas, okay? So before this call, we talked about a company called Catalyst, which is a data collection organization. And I would ask everybody to look up this company and go to their website and read it and educate yourselves. The company is called catalyst.us. And I'm going to hold my phone up here so everyone can kind of see how to spell catalyst. It's CATALIST. .us. Catalyst is one of the multitude of databases that collects data on private citizens. That data is then exclusively shared with progressive or Democrat candidates. Catalyst, right on their website, claims that they have 256 million data profiles. Okay.
Now, David, as we were talking before, you read something off of there where it talked about that yes, they share the data only with progressives and Democrats.
Yes. We do this by providing our data only to Democrats and progressives. Okay. They do not share this data with conservatives. And if you find out the people that are behind this company, they're not even Americans. Okay. So
I have a question. I have a question about the data then. If that data is collected by us, I mean, what about all these like HIPAA laws and stuff where you can't share, you know, your data? Are they still getting that data, and is it still going out to other places, like from our phones and stuff?
Yeah. So I'm gonna describe to you how they get their data. Okay. So every single day in the United States, there's a company that. One of the companies that does it is called Amdocs. It's amdocs.com. I had a lot of dealings. I wouldn't say a lot of dealings. I had several negotiations when Amdocs was included. I have very high level experience of Amdocs. Amdocs is a company that's ran by the Mossad out of Israel. It's a very successful technology company. And the stuff that they do, I wouldn't even repeat, because I do think that some of the stuff they do is great, but I also think that some of the stuff they do is undermining the people in this country. So every single day, every single person in this country with a mobile phone, the data coming out of those phones is collected. And every single day, there's a database that collects 7,000 points of data on average from each phone in the United States. So every time you type something, you talk, you browse something, if you're driving down the road and you make a left turn, that's a point that there's several points of data that gets recorded. So they build these profiles on people to be able to track these people. And, you know, you've heard the word cookies. When you go to websites, it collects data.
Right.
You know, there's all kinds of
What is that? What is it actually? when it says, you know, do you accept the cookies? What does that actually mean?
Well, you have to read, each website has a different policy. So, if you just go to, the local Chevy dealership website and it says you have to accept their cookies policy, you know, they're going to collect data on, you know, if you give them first of all, they're going to grab your IP address. They match IP addresses with databases to get your contact information. And I'll explain how that works.
Is a VPN good to have? Because I recently got a VPN. Is that good to have?
I don't know. I mean, it might help a little bit, but you know, it's not the end all be all solution. I'm going to get into the end all be all solution that Americans need to be fighting for, and you know, IP blockers and stuff is not it. So anyway, back to the Chevy dealership. They'll collect your location information, your IP address, your browsing history off the website. They compile that. It goes into databases. It's matched. It's kind of like how a collection agency might get your personal data. They'll end up with your phone number if you call in, and then they'll take that phone number, match it to a database, and get your everything else about you. And it's very easy. You can buy data profiles for penny a piece and gets all of someone's information for a penny if you bought enough data from data providers. As a marketing guy, data is great because you could target your market. You could target your audience that you want to market to and save a lot of money in marketing dollars because you're not wasting money advertising to the wrong people. However, data today has been used. The way that they're using data today, I don't think it's going to cost us an election, but the stuff that we're going through today with this election fraud all came down to data. They were able to use data to know down to which street in the United States needed X amount of one more Democrat voter in this subdivision is all we need. And they had teams and teams and teams of people out there organizing to go and make sure that each little zip code in these areas got just enough votes. Okay. And the people out there doing these door knockings, they were reporting all this data. And as they reported the data, the manipulators of the left, they know exactly what they need to manipulate. So these poll lot, these people in these manager of these poll locations, they know in a certain zip code how many Trump votes they need to throw in the garbage and how many new Biden votes they need to have to win a certain territory. And it was a very, very, very targeted and very organized effort. It wasn't just, you know, this is going to be played off as a bunch of people that worked at these ballot collection locations. They were just mad at Trump and they were just changing stuff and they were individually mad. And the computer system had a glitch, so it wasn't really anybody's fault. It just kind of happened. A couple of people will end up in jail, and nobody will get prosecuted. So, and Linda, I switched my screen here. So anyway, I'd like to get into. I've got my whiteboard here. I know it's kind of hard to read because my handwriting's not too good, but if you take a look at this, in the center here, I have these two companies that work together. There's a bunch of companies that work together. These are just two examples, which is Amdocs and Catalyst. And then around them, where all this data it comes from and where it's all shared. So a couple of things I didn't put on here is credit bureaus. So the three credit bureaus in the United States, including a company called the Fair Isaac Corporation, it's located in California. I'm sure everybody's heard of a FICO score. That FICO score uses an algorithm and uses data to determine our ability to pay back money and our credit worthiness and our habitual patterns on spending and all that stuff. So they have this extremely sophisticated data model and data mining model that that builds profiles on me to so that they can tell a bank how worthy you are when it comes down to borrowing money. And what a lot of people don't know is back in May, as the COVID crisis is going on and Donald Trump's pushing out this loan and this grant program for small businesses, the Fair Isaac Corporation that manages the FICO score, they removed up to 75 points from 13 million small business owners. So 13 million self-employed people had up to 75 points taken off their credit score. And what they were trying to do is their excuse was, hey, all we're doing is lowering credit scores. That way it decreases the risk of banks that are relying on us to tell them whether or not a person is creditworthy or not. And in a time of crisis like this, yes, we should de-rank self-employed people because they're going to go and have a knee-jerk reaction to a market situation, and they're going to borrow a bunch of money that they potentially can't pay back. So we would like to just show responsible lending or empower banks with responsible lending practices. When in actuality, their stock, I think their stock went from $800 to $1,100. You can research that, but it's the FICO Corporation, F-I-C-O, Fair Isaac Corporation. They have no government oversight, and FICO determines who gets to borrow money. So here we are in this pandemic that I call it's a plandemic, and all of these Democrat-ran organizations are working against Christian conservative values. So here you have 13 million people get their credit profiles wiped out. So all of a sudden they're dead in the water with their business and they can't borrow money and they're out of business and it hurts the economy. And the Democrat mafia, they're even, you know, knowing of those 13 million people, I can't tell how many of them were Democrat versus Republican, but the Democrats are very happy to cannibalize their own for the cause. And you know, you could talk to the average Democrat person and they will agree with that. Well, there's collateral damage. Well, what if it happens to you? Okay, of course, none of them want it to happen to them. They, you know, individuals don't want to go out of business. They don't mind if somebody else does. So here you have in my little chart that I drew right here in the center, you have these two companies that do a lot of data pooling and they distribute a lot of data and they have a lot of control over what me and you see, what everyone in this country sees and hears on a daily basis. So right here, you have the three credit bureaus working with these guys. Right here, you have international special interest groups by the tens of thousands working with these guys. Over here, you have organized corporations in our country by the tens of thousands working with these guys, reporting data on people like me and you. And you go to Amazon and you buy something from Amazon, your shopping habits are all put in this data pool. Up here you have Hollywood. So our viewing experiences on Netflix and again, Amazon Prime, all that goes into this data pool right here, okay? Right here you have social media, all the big social media organizations, LinkedIn, Instagram, Twitter, they're all a consortium of reporting into this data pool. You have the mobile phone service providers such as AT&T, Verizon, T-Mobile, Sprint, Cricket, all of them taking this data and reporting into this data pool. Okay, now keep in mind this data pool is a Democrat exclusive data pool. Okay, you have the mainstream media and you have social impact groups. This year, there were over 3,000 social impact groups that were out there door knocking, standing in front of grocery stores, et cetera, college, universities, high schools, reporting their data to these data systems. Okay. These data systems then hash this data out and they spit it back out to the Democrat Party to use as, you know, a machine against conservatism and Christianity. So, you know, with all the things, there's a lot of things in this country that we need to be working on and talking on and fighting. But the one thing that we need to be fighting on is there's kind of a dual-headed solution to this situation. One is individual data ownership. So What we really need to be pressing on in this, whoever ends up as president, we need to make it a very, very, very high priority to have the government to create laws that puts the data in my data is owned by me. So none of these organizations can have my data. It's locked in a little data box inside of my phone in a program. And when I get to a website, they can purchase it from me. They can give me a discount on a service if I want to let them have access to my mobile data or my shopping history data or my medical data. Okay. But unfortunately, the way that the law is set up right now, all of this data gets to be used by organizations that's fighting to take my rights and your rights and the rights of everybody else that'll ever watch this video.
So Dave, I have a question. Is that include medical information? Because, you know, with all these HIPAA laws, you know, supposedly, you know, your medical information is protected.
Yeah, there's medical data happening, being shared. It's not to the extent of everything else, but it wouldn't be hard to get your medical data.
Yeah.
You know, there's the black web, the dark web, nothing, you know, they're all working together. The hackers, there's databases getting
hacked.
But
how do they get it? How do they get the information if it's supposed to be, you know, like with your doctor? I mean, how do they get that information?
Yeah. Well, this call that we're on right now is Zoom. Zoom sells every word that we're speaking goes into a database and is shared and sold.
Really?
Absolutely. So when you have, I did a telemedicine call this year on Zoom. That's not safe, but nothing's safe. There are systems out there that can't be hacked, but if someone wanted your data, your medical data is out there. You're not getting around that.
Yeah. That's interesting.
I'll tell you a quick story, a funny story. I had a buddy who was a Alice Cooper fan, and he really wanted me to get Alice Cooper's address. So a friend of mine who was sitting there with us at lunch talking about it is a black hat guy. And a couple days later, I get a thumb drive shows up at our office with Alice Cooper's, all of his medical information on it.
Oh my goodness.
Including his home address. Yeah. So, nothing safe, Linda.
Yeah.
You know, you have these medical billing, these people that work from home doing medical coding for medical billing. You've probably heard of that.
Yeah.
So much information gets hacked through that process.
I was just watching something on, you know, talking about the VPN. And then, you know, there's the what is it, Tor browser, but they're basically saying, you know, it's secure unless, you know, you've got somebody that's in your root, you know, in your root or whatever. So people, you know, and you think about that, and I have a Mac, so.
Yep.
Guess what? My Mac, I have to give my personal computer information to them so they can go, so I can get iCloud onto my computer.
Yes.
That tells me that they can get into my computer. I mean, that nothing's safe.
Yes. Yeah. So we should not, as citizens, we should not be relying on having to go buy a device to try to keep our data safe.
Right.
Data falls into the wrong. Data is in the wrong hands today. I was getting ready to say it can fall into the wrong hands, or it falls into the wrong hands all the time. It's in the wrong hands today. It's in the hands of the people doing the devil's work. And, you know, it's not fair for any human being to know. I just did the math. When you look at the amount of data that's collected in the United States, I'm going to do it again. It's 256 million individuals getting 7,000 points of data reported on them on a daily basis. It's 1,792,000,000 pieces of data on a daily basis going into these data centers, these collection centers. Yeah. So we're being spied on as a nation. And the only, you know, the only solution, I mean, the convenience of mobile technology and computing technology, it makes us efficient and it helps us make money and it helps our country be strong and helps us be quick and responsive. And that's something that we should not put away. But at the same time, we have to go into tomorrow. We have to wake up every single individual in this country and we have to fight for data privacy. If the Democrat Party did not have this data, they probably wouldn't have gotten more than 20 million votes this year, because this data drives them to be able to manipulate people. Okay. Last week, a girl that my son grew up with posted a thing on Facebook about how she has no respect for people that vote for Donald Trump. And, you know, I sent her a private message and I just said, hey, can you explain to me why? They can't explain why, other than I've been watching these videos all day on how bad Trump is and how he's locking people in cages and taking the rights of Black people and taking the rights of gay people. And he's going to, you know, prevent gay people from being able to love who they want to love. And if they love the wrong person, they can go to jail for it. Like, she's completely manipulated. She's seeing they're putting these videos in front of her all day long to convince her of something that's not true.
Yeah.
So you have, you know, she ends up, you know, actually another person in that same little group that my son used to hang out with, you know, they're sending hate mail to my family, you know, digital mail to my family for being Trump supporters. And I said, hey, I didn't vote for Donald Trump. And they said, what? You didn't? I said, no. We never got our mail-in ballots. I couldn't.
For real? You never got a mail, but you could go and, oh, that's right. Cause you moved recently, right?
We moved. And before I moved, I went to the election commission, told them we were moving, you know, opted in for a mail-in ballot, but on election day, we got a document in the mail saying that we had to re-register because there was complications in software.
So can you still technically, because of that, is there any exceptions for some things like that? You'd think there.
I don't know. I'd have to make some phone calls, but you know, at this point in time, I don't know. I mean, in my opinion, this is going to go into courts, and I have a lot of different opinions. But we don't have to get into any of that right now. My whole point to talking to you today, Linda, is really just to get this story out there so people understand that there are tens of thousands of organizations working together to defeat Christian conservatism in this country. And
so how can Christians, what can we do, you know, to be light and salt and not just, you know, sit back and not do anything? What can a Christian do? We obviously we could pray, we could trust the
yes.
Lord, but what is there anything natural we can do?
Yeah, so, well, first of all, pressuring your state representatives into this. The laws that are out there were all created by this consortium here. They're the ones that made the laws. They're the ones that need the data to manipulate everybody. Each individual has a voice, and our individual voices need to work together, just like these groups work together, to overwhelm our policymakers here in this country. And they have to create policy that gives us, the people, the control and the freedom that this country is meant for. If we do not do that, and we continue to let these organizations and these consortiums to have their way, mm-hmm. then they will have their way to the point where we won't have a choice in what way they want. So every individual needs to wake up tomorrow and understand that God did not make us to be passive, lazy, sideline watching people. Okay. We are to be active. We are to fight and write letters and do all that we can to make our voice known. Okay. So I am in the process of launching. It's something that I'm launching. It's called David's Plan. It's just a plan that I wrote, which are the top 20 things that Christians need to be doing in their routines. I encourage men to get out there and find a young man to mentor. There's an abundance of fatherless boys out there that are in their teens. If you look at the next, don't quote me on this, the next 4 years that there's, you know, there's millions of eligible voters coming down the pipe right now. Okay. The devil is going to use these organizations to get in their heads, to make them hateful and dependent and put them in the mentality of to implant the mentality in their minds that they are victims of something. And when they're victims of something, they hate what's victimizing them. You know, there's a lot of people that currently today believe that they're victims of something Trump is doing. When the fact is, if you look at policy that's created by Democrat Party since the very beginning of the Democrat Party, it's been about slavery and enslaving. And all because they make a hate crime bill doesn't mean that someone gets more freedoms and more rights. It just means that someone loses freedoms and loses rights, okay? So every time there's some kind of a Democrat policy that's created, someone is gonna lose rights. And then there's the facade over here where someone has more rights, okay? So, you know, gay people don't have, a gay man does not have any less rights or protections in this country as a straight man. A man is a man, policy is policy, freedom is freedom. Okay, so we need to be very active on engaging with the next generation on a personal level and taking the time to go sit down and mentor and show love to these young people, okay? Teach them the truth. Right now, I have a young person that lives here at my home, and he's, you know, I don't want to say too much, but he was not in a very good position, and we brought him in, and you know, he's a freedom-loving, conservative, Christian-thinking young man who was maybe the opposite of that 6 months ago. But, you know, we've had a lot of young people come into our home, and it is risky bringing a stranger with juvenile issues coming into your home. And I'm not saying for everyone to go and bring someone into their home, but I am saying that every Christian adult who, you know, our own children do need to be high on our priority list, but there's always room to bring another young person into your life and to talk to them and show them love. And I could tell you another scenario of a young lady we've shown all kinds of love to, and our house is open to her. And she just, you know, the Lord showed me a vision of her one day. And I told my family that girl, for now, she's lost. So, you know, she, you know, doesn't engage with us much anymore. But at the end of the day, again, I'm launching something called David's Plan. It's my, you know, it's not a commandment of God. It's just a suggestion, what I'm going to suggest the citizens of this country to be active in doing. And, you know, we've all overlooked, everybody hears of data all the time, but very few people that I've talked to even understand, even people in technology spaces don't even understand the depth, you know, like I just said, 1.7 billion points of data collected on every American adult every day to be used against, it's not used against the people, all the people. I mean, they're collecting it from all the people and they're using it against all of the people. There's no one that is going to be immune from the devil when he finally gets his claws into this country and takes it. Okay. There's some other things that we could talk about later. Something, Jan Markell, Olive Tree Ministries, she talks about this all the time, something called the red green axis, which where you have Islam and communism coming together. You know, this, you know, the devil is controlling so many people of influence in this world, and they all want one thing, which is the takedown of our country and the elimination of our freedoms. So I, you know, I do believe that the church, the light will never, ever be put out. They can kill everyone, and there's going to be one left that goes again and starts making it happen. Amen. But I don't want to be, me or any of my family, be part of the atrocities that's coming when the rights of this nation are taken. And
So what are some of the other things, David, that you talk about mentoring? What are, do you have some other things you could share that could give some people some ideas on?
Yeah, absolutely. So if you look from the outside in, so if you talk to a young person or someone that's not a Christian and you say, hey, you want to go to church, or what do you think about God, or what do you think about Christianity? They're going to, in their mind, they're going to relate to an experience they had with some hateful scenario inside of a church where there was something that, some hypocrisy thing or some hate thing that happened, some bad experience they had. So one of the things that, you know, as you know, we're trying to do these movie events, and the whole goal with these movie events is to bring tens of thousands of churches together, thousands of denominations to come together with communities and bring non-believers into churches and to show the world that we're all working together just on a movie that has no, they don't even talk about God in our movies. They're just good stories to bring the community together. I believe churches need to quit wasting all their space Monday through Saturday and open their doors up maybe for some community interaction, maybe for some free office space for local startups to work. I believe that churches in general need to be less concerned about their church brand, be more concerned about our freedoms and our liberties, and more concerned about showing the true love of Christ rather than promoting their goals as a their goals and intentions as a church brand. I'm not wording that properly, but so that's a couple of things. Secondly, you know, we need to spend a lot more time educating ourselves. I'm 43. I still have mentors. When I was 20 years old, before I was a Christian, I used to go into bars during the day and talk to old guys that were in World War II or Vietnam, and you know, always talk to somebody more successful than me or more experienced than me. When I was 18, I was a bodybuilder. I went to one of the more successful bodybuilders at the time and got mentored by the guy, you know. So, and I became, you know, pretty good at that. You know, I never was the magazine superstar, but I achieved my goals. But we need to drop our pride and show more love and come together as a church and really put some consideration on, you know, I understand churches need to keep their doors open. They need that. They need their revenue streams to keep their doors open. But I think they need to keep their doors open, okay, for more people to come in, interact. And if you look at Mormonism, they have their family events and they have basketball courts in their wards, and anybody can go in there at any time, not any time, but they have their times when the communities can go in there and participate with them. And it's, you know, I don't agree with LDS doctrine by no means, but I do watch what they're doing. And I think we as Christians should look at that and take a few notes. We need to be more active in politics. I could walk into a church of 200 people and say, hey, does anybody know who's running in our city, in our county, in our district, in our state? And nobody knows who the congressman is. Nobody knows who the mayor is. Nobody knows who the judge is. Okay. You have all kinds of foreign dollars coming into this country to back these district attorneys and the state prosecutors, and Christians are just sitting there going to church and then thinking because they went to church, they have this super relationship with God and they have this super anointing on them and nothing can happen to them. And that, you know, we have to ask every one of us for two things, which is one, for God to drop our pride, and two, for God to give us fear of him. Okay. So when we get that fear of God, we begin to get more knowledge of God and more understanding of God because we fear him. So what I'm praying doesn't happen. You know, I'm praying about a month ago and I told the Lord, I said, I'm going to start talking about this stuff instead of me being silent. I have an outlet. I can exercise my voice. I can knock on doors. I can talk to people. You know, I've got documents that I keep in my car that if I see someone with a Joe Biden sticker, I will walk over to gas station and ask them a question that usually gets on their nerves and then show them, well, this is actually true, what I just said, right? I literally had several people asking me if they can change their vote, you know, just by having a 5-minute conversation with a stranger. So, but I'm able to do that because I'm confident in the knowledge that I have that I can walk up to the stranger and I have, if nothing else, I'm not going to get proven wrong. I might get a no, but I'm not going to get proven wrong on the topic of conversation that I'm going to present to that person.
Yeah.
So it's important.
I think that's a really good, really good point, David. I mean, I was shocked this election. My pastor Dave, my husband, he talked one Sunday morning about biblically voting, and you know, we're not voting for the person, we're voting on the platform. And if you go to biblicalvoter.com. I was shocked. Like, the Democrats have 76 pages of their, you know, so-called, you know, platform. And then the Democrats have a 66 page, but I mean, the, you know, God was only mentioned one time in the Democrats. And I guess, according to that, Dave said it was like a debate, whether they were even going to include that one. Republican one, I think it was like 15 times or 16 times. And, you know, like pro-life, I mean, obviously all of the different things, even bipartisan, the word wasn't even used in the Democrat. It was used only in the Republican. So the platform is what we're voting on, and we're not voting on, you know, a personality. And you know, I think Donald Trump has done a phenomenal job. If you just look at what he's done, he's put in Christian or, you know, godly judges. He's done more for, you know, blessing Israel. He has took down the Johnson, you know, the Johnson Amendment that put a muzzle on our ability to talk as pastors before our election.
Yes.
He's given more money to Black colleges so that they don't have to enroll every year to get money. He's just done so many things, you know, stopping the sex trafficking and I mean, wrote a, you know, he in December, I think 21st in 2018, signed a executive order seizing all of the assets of anybody who is in internationally trading in drugs and sex trafficking. And so, you know, he's done phenomenal things, but people don't know it. And again, they don't even know what they're voting for. And so I was shocked, you know, talking to Christians, people that voted for Biden, they don't even know what the platform stands for. And yet they're voting for him just because they didn't like a personality. They didn't like, because the mainstream media makes, you know, President Trump look really bad, when if people knew what he's done. But they don't, you know,
yeah.
You can't listen to the mainstream media. You've got to go watch them, watch the briefings, go right to the source and listen to what he's talking about. Don't listen. You can't listen to, I would watch a briefing, and I still go to the White House briefing, go to White House YouTube channel, the White House channel, watch the briefings. I'd watch them, and then I'd watch the, you know, or see something posted on Facebook from like CNN or one of those other ones. And it's like, they just got through saying something totally opposite what he just said. And yes. So you couldn't believe a thing they said. And so I just quit. I mean, I don't watch the mainstream media, because a person would be totally brainwashed. And like you said, hating President Trump because they don't tell you what he's actually done. So
yeah,
it's absolutely important that we know, and this is, you know, what I think is we need to get back to researching for ourselves, thinking for ourselves, thinking deeper. We can't just because somebody, you know, blabs something out there, we can't just believe it. We've got to do some research, not only research, but realize, you know, the Bible says Satan is a liar and he's the author of lying. He's going to try and cause division. And so that's his tactic. Of course, he's going to use, you know, the mainstream media too, because, you know, they're basically controlled by, I think there's like six people or something like that, six corporations or whatever that own the majority of the mainstream media. So, I mean, it's going to be used by the enemy unless the Christians start getting together, like you said, and thinking deeper, researching, and getting together and getting, you know, our own media, our own things out there, you know?
Yeah, well, we have to be more active as a unit. And, you know, it would be my dream to have one organization that everyone kind of gets behind that fights for, everyone that you talk to, just 99.9% of everyone that you talk to wants the same three things, which are prosperity, individual liberty, and peace. Okay, on both sides, blue and red, that's what we want. And if the church came together to fight for those three things, it benefits everyone, not just us. It benefits everyone. And unfortunately, there are too many people fighting against those three things. They're fighting against peace, they're fighting against prosperity, and they're fighting against individual liberty. So again, I'm putting together the content for our site right now. Again, it's just going to be David's plan. I haven't bought the domain yet. I'm still working on that. And it's just going to be my suggestions based off of my experience in Washington, my experience in Silicon Valley, traveling, all the things I've been involved in. I'm just going to make some suggestions and pray that it takes root and that we can get enough people behind it to, again, I think we need to start with data and completely end the ability for the devil to have my data to use against my kids and me.
Yeah. Amen.
And that's where let's
just pray. And, I believe what we have authority and we have God's mind. So hallelujah. Father, I just thank you for this time. And I just pray, God, that you would just use it for your word, Father, to go forth, for the Christians to become the light and the salt in the earth, Father God, that you said in Isaiah 60, arise, shine, for the light has come and the glory of the Lord has risen upon us, that great darkness will be upon the earth, but the glory of the Lord will be upon us. So Lord, I just pray that your church would arise and shine, become that beautiful bride in the earth, Lord, that without wrinkle or blemish, Lord God, but they would just become that beautiful bride, united in power and anointing and going forth. And like David said, would become united in the purpose so that we can defeat the enemy and his plans against us, Lord. So we thank you, God, that you're frustrating the plans of the enemy and that the church is arising. But I just pray for David that you give him just a wisdom and guidance in all that he's doing, Father God, in business and just open doors for them in Jesus' name. And we thank you that you have the keys of the kingdom and the keys of David. You said you open doors that no man can shut. You shut doors that no man can open. So I thank you for just blessing him, blessing his family, going before him, open doors for him, show him things to come, teach him, and bless him, Lord, I pray. Bless his family, Lord. Bless Candace, Lord. We just thank you, God, for their whole family and everything that he's doing, Lord. We just bless it in Jesus' name. And thank you for using this time to bring, Lord, glory to you and reaching people for your kingdom in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Well, thank you for joining me today on the program, David. And if there's anyone that's watching today that doesn't know Jesus, you can know him. Just ask him in your heart. Get to know him. It's just a relationship. Just say, Jesus, come, be my Lord, my Savior. I can't save myself. I'm sorry for my sin. And he'll let you in to his heart and get to know him, live for him. And it's the best thing that'll ever happen to your life.
Surrender exclusively to God. It is a beautiful, beautiful way of life.
Yeah. Amen. Amen. We'll have to talk about that sometime, David, because I know God is what the Lord has done for you. So thank you for watching. Thank you, David, for being on the program today. And
thank you very much.
God bless. And we'll have another chat some other time. All right.
God bless you too. Thank you.
Yep. God bless. Have a good one. Bye-bye.
Yep, thanks. Bye.
Thanks for watching. And if you'd like to watch more programs, go to lindacross.com or Living Hope, and you'll be able to see some archives of the program. So God bless. Have a great day.